Dear listeners, greetings from Halifax, Canada. My name is Ashwani Kumar and I am an Associate Professor of Education at Mount St. Vincent University. I am delighted to share my thoughts with you on the second edition of the International Handbook of Curriculum Research, which was published by Routledge in 2014. I would like to begin by thanking Mahmoud Mehermo Hamadi, who invited me to prepare this brief talk for you and who is also a contributing author of the chapter on Iranian curriculum studies in the handbook under consideration. The International Handbook of Curriculum Research is a tremendous pioneering contribution to the internationalization of curriculum studies discourses. Its editor is the world-famous curriculum theorist and educator William Pinar, a leader of the reconceptualization movement of curriculum studies in North America during the 1970s, Pinar continues to be one of the most renowned curriculum scholars in the world. One of the key contributions of his scholarship is viewing the curriculum as an international text. Internationalization of curriculum studies requires and creates spaces where curriculum scholars working around the world in their own contexts engage in what he calls complicated conversation with one another. Such complicated conversation, structured by diverse cultural, political, philosophical, and theoretical viewpoints, allows curriculum scholars to look at curriculum and the factors that shape it, for example, history, politics, economy, and culture, in deeper and broader ways. Pinar has contributed many books and articles to support the internationalization of curriculum studies. His edited volumes on the intellectual histories and present circumstances of curriculum studies in South Africa, Brazil, Mexico, China, and India, as well as the two editions of the International Handbook of Curriculum Research, are remarkably groundbreaking. The second edition of the International Handbook of Curriculum Research has three parts. The first part is an introductory chapter by Pinar that helpfully introduces the readers to the purposes and contents of the book. The second part comprises five chapters by renowned curriculum scholars who consider the issues of internationalization of curriculum from varied perspectives. The final part contains 39 country-specific reports of curriculum research from 34 countries. Now, I will discuss the key ideas put forth in the five introductory essays. Ciro Otto's chapter, Internationalization of Curriculum Research, critiques the neoliberal emphasis on instrumental education that emphasizes standardization, measurement, comparison, and undermines transformative education. Otto underscores the importance of progressive and transformative educational concepts like Bildung, Curere, and ideas from the Eastern wisdom traditions to repair the damage done by economically driven instrumental approaches to teaching and learning. His work encourages us educators to view curriculum and teaching as deeply moral and subjective rather than superficially focused on testing and comparison. Cameron McCarthy, Ergin Bulut, and Rushika Patel's piece, Race and Education in the Age of Digital Capitalism, highlights the complexity of the present world marked by digital technologies, neoliberal market policies, and popular culture, and the ways in which these together have changed the way we look at the notion of race, identity, and culture around the world. Given the intensifying complexity of social interaction, growing economic and political instabilities, and increasing individual and relational vulnerabilities, McCarthy, Bulut, and Patel call for imaginative ways of looking at the notion of researching race and culture, as well as renegotiating in fundamental ways what counts as meaningful education for the youth. David Geoffrey Smith's essay, Wisdom Responses to Globalization, provides another effective critique of neoliberal global capitalism and its negative impact on education, as reflected in the so-called educational reforms that emphasize standardization, superficial skill orientation, and online learning instead of deeper engagement and exploration of the global crisis. Smith underscores the importance of teaching and learning from the perspectives of wisdom traditions of the East and the West. These wisdom traditions collectively celebrate the unity of life and appreciate awareness and mindfulness as the ways to heal oneself and thereby one's relationships with human beings and nature, which can pave the way for global healing. Daniel Troller's chapter, International Curriculum Research, provides an intriguing analysis of the differences between curriculum research in the US and Germany, highlighting how history and politics give rise to unique constructions of curricular knowledge. Troller makes two key recommendations for curriculum research. One, he underscores the importance of paying attention to the larger social, political, and historical context within which curriculum is located, rather than just focusing on the schools and the policies that govern them. And number two, he encourages curriculum scholars to appreciate the significance of comparing curriculum genealogies of different countries and contexts, which would allow us to become aware of ourselves as historical and cultural constructions. Drawing upon the international wisdom traditions and non-violence activism, Hongyu Wang's piece, A Non-Violent Perspective on Internationalizing Curriculum Studies, calls upon the discipline of curriculum studies to embrace non-violence as an educational vision. Non-violence as a way of being supports dialogue, communication, and connection, which we desperately need in our uncertain and violent world. Considering nonviolence as the core of education has tremendous promise to cultivate ethical, globally minded, and compassionate individuals who can challenge the comparison and competition-driven neoliberal ethos of education in our contemporary society. These five essays are followed by 39 country-specific reports of curriculum research from 34 countries. While it is beyond the scope to summarize and comment on each of these chapters here, I must point out that all of these chapters are written in a very accessible manner that allows the reader to get a good glimpse of the historical evolution and contemporary circumstances of curriculum research in these unique political, cultural, and economic contexts. Reading these essays, one realizes how differently curriculum is viewed around the world, and yet at the same time, one notices the forces that influence curriculum globally, namely neoliberalism, government control of education, and the colonial and imperial impositions on what knowledge is of most worth. Overall, I think the International Handbook of Curriculum Research makes the following contributions to the field of curriculum studies worldwide. Number one, it establishes curriculum studies as a worldwide discipline which respects differences and allows diverse perspectives on curriculum to interact with each other. Number two, it allows curriculum scholars from around the world to share how curriculum is viewed within their and their colleagues' national boundaries and how their specific context shapes the notion of the curriculum. Number three, it provides a panoramic view of the diverse kinds of research taking place around the world. It makes scholarly work available for curriculum scholars so that they may become apprised of what's happening in other parts of the world in order to reflect on their own particular circumstances and find similarities and differences which can allow them to engage with each other in a more deeper way. It underlines how capitalism-driven economic globalization and neoliberalization have become common around the world through their emphasis on the commodification of education and reliance on standardized testing, comparison, and competition, all of which are anti-educational notions which undermine academic freedom, creativity, collaboration, and holistic development. Number five, it shows how curriculum in the majority of the countries around the world is controlled by dominant political, economic, and social ideologies, and how colonialism and imperialism continue to affect educational system in many countries through their imposition of colonial viewpoints or the import of educational notions from the West. Number six, it allows curriculum studies scholars to see which philosophical, theoretical, methodological, and practice-oriented perspectives are being used to conduct curriculum research around the world, which can provide input for their own research program. Finally, it respects diverse intellectual and wisdom traditions from around the world and thereby promotes collegiality, dialogue, and connections among educators internationally. My own recent book, Curriculum in International Contexts, Understanding Colonial, Ideological, and Neoliberal Influences, which has been published by Palgrave Macmillan in 2019, draws upon and contributes to the internationalization of curriculum studies discourses, which is the core purpose of the International Handbook. My book draws on two decades of my engagement with various international themes in social studies and curriculum studies, including my work with Dr. Pinar, who was my doctoral supervisor at the University of British Columbia, and who provided me with the opportunity to work on his internationalization of curriculum studies projects. My book basically is an exposition of how political, cultural, historical, and economic structures and processes shape curriculum landscapes globally. Colonialism and imperialism, state-led ideological control, and the wave of neoliberalism and capitalism have insidiously impacted the process of curriculum development in different parts of the world, as is also explicit in the International Handbook. Like the International Handbook, my text underscores how intellectual movements such as Marxism and postmodernism have shaped curriculum theory in varied political and economic settings. Being a study of diverse cultural and political conceptualizations of curriculum and the interconnections among them, my book also takes a step towards the internationalization of curriculum studies discourses. In my book, I identify and discuss four theoretical responses: indigenous, critical, autobiographical, and meditative, that can provide thoughtful perspectives to challenge negative influences on curriculum, including neoliberalism, colonialism, and ideological control of teaching. I invite the listeners of this audio to engage with my ideas further and share their feedback with me. Thank you very much for listening.